Follow me on Twitter at Rashad1380, Instagram, Rashad, period, Richard, Rashad underscore Richie. Archived interviews, articles, and commentary can be found at v-103.com or waok.com. Twitter, at Rashad1380. Don't forget, follow me. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, especially for those who live in Stonecrest, the newly formed city, or who do business in the newly formed city of Stonecrest, I need your attention. This is something that we've been talking about today. I put it out over the weekend that we would hold this forum for those who are running for mayor of the city. In the studio, I have Jason Larry. How are you, sir?
I'm good, sir. How you doing?
Excellent. I have Douglas Favors II. How are you?
Good. Thank you.
And I have Charles Hill II. How are you?
Doing well, brother. How about you?
Excellent. Let's get into it. I told you guys that we would do a two-minute opening, and let's start there. I will start with Mr. Charles Hill II with his two-minute opening, and we will go this way from that point. Go ahead, sir.
Good afternoon. My name is Charles Hill. I am a resident of the city of Stonecrest that is currently seeking the office of mayor in the newly formed city of Stonecrest, Georgia. I grew up in the community. I am a 2003 graduate of Lithonia High School, 2008 graduate of Morehouse College. I have a master's degree from Harvard University, where I graduated in 2012, and I'm finishing a terminal degree at Yale University. I'm very concerned about the newly created city of Stonecrest because it's the community I grew up in. While the city will only start off with three services, zoning, parks and recreation, and code enforcement, I want to be very, very aggressive about what type of businesses are coming into our community. We need fewer liquor stores, fewer fast food restaurants. We need healthier eating options. We need our streets clean. Although we won't start off with a police department, I want to work with the DeKalb County Police Department, DeKalb County Sheriff's Department to increase patrols in the area. I want to see more positive growth and development in the community. And I want to see a neighborhood where our residents will have a very direct line to their representative local city elected office holders. So again, my name is Charles Hill. I grew up in the city of Stonecrest. I'm someone that's very, very concerned about what's happening in our community. And I think that throughout this this on-air interview today, we'll have an opportunity to discuss some of the issues. To get a better look at my platform, please go to charleshillforstonecrest.com, and you'll be able to take a look at many of the issues I'm addressing in this campaign. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir. We appreciate your intro. Let's go to Douglas Favors II.
Like always, if you've been to anything and heard me speak, I'm going to start off by telling you it's Favors, the number four, mayor.com. My platform is going to be the only platform you hear starting off to tell you that beautification through code enforcement is the only way to go. There's a lot of issues that Stonecrest is going to have to deal with, but we're talking about doing something at a foundation, and beautification through code enforcement starts that foundation, from security to better businesses being attracted to the area and residents coming to the area itself and keeping the young people there. Code enforcement means that we are going to actually do things that force businesses and to be responsible for the locations that they have owned. It's going to also force residents to be responsible for the locations that they live in. It's going to increase lighting around the city. We're talking about sidewalks. We're talking about crosswalks. We're talking about things that, since we won't have our own police department to start off with, these are the things that police officers have told me themselves helps them do their job better, with a big thing being something like lighting, because you don't know how difficult it is for folks to get to you for help if they can't even see the numbers on the mailboxes themselves. I mean, we got a lot of things that need work, and beautification through code enforcement is my platform to start that work immediately, so you don't have to wait around to say, I voted for this guy, he's mayor now, what's really going on? You'll see that within 6 months that construction of these type of things will start, and that's the basis of everything, including economic development. Again, I graduated from Georgia Southern University in 2005 with a graduate degree in marketing and business. I got a master's in leadership from Shorter University. I am from Augusta, Georgia. I have family all over Georgia, from Savannah to Columbus. My wife is from Warner Robins. So, again, I've been telling folks all day and since day one that, no, I haven't lived in Stonecrest particularly my whole life or anything like that. But I am from Georgia, and I'm definitely wearing that on my back. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And Mr. Jason Larry.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for having us. I'm Jason Larry, and you can reach me at jasonlarryformayor.com, J-A-S-O-N-L-A-R-Y, one R in my last name, for mayor.com. Sir, I am the president of the Stonecrest City Alliance, the group that put together the opportunity for the city of Stonecrest to come to be. and also the chairman of Stonecrest. Yes, and that is the advocacy group that made it possible for us to achieve the 60% vote to get Stonecrest as a city. I'm a 25-year resident of Stonecrest. I've been married for 30 years, have two grown kids. Quite frankly, sir, I am following the will of the people. And the will of the people starts with live, work, play, worship, shop, educate. Live, work, play, worship, shop, educate. And, sir, those six keys are the keys for a successful city worldwide, whether it's from Macon, Georgia, or from Bangladesh. Those six things has to happen. And how we came from that is that being able to go out and talk with the folk, with the people for over 4 years to decide what is it that they wanted out of a city. What is it they wanted to do? So this is brand new for us, sir. It's a brand new city, brand new opportunity. This takes place of the old things that were happening in the past. This is my first time running for office and probably the second time me being on the air, period.
All right.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, all of you, for being here. We're coming to a break. There it is. Welcome back. 404-892-2703. I'm with all three mayoral candidates for the city of Stonecrest, which is in DeKalb County, city of Stonecrest, newly formed city, voted on by the citizens of that city. I have in studio Douglas Favors II, Charles Hill II, and also Jason Larry. We just heard their introductions. Let me ask this. What are the most pressing issues for the city of Stonecrest? Each one will have a minute and 30 seconds to answer these questions. If you include the name of one of your opponents in your answer, I will give your opponent some time to rebuttal, okay? And I will start that with Jason Larry.
Thank you, sir. The most pressing issue and why the city was created is economic development. Jobs, 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 careers, careers, careers in our footprint, in our area, being able to take care of ourselves with regards to being able to work and bring major corporations and increase our small business and medium-sized business footprint in the Stonecrest region. We have three areas out there that need vital help in that arena. One, industrial park. Two, the commercial area. Three, the recovery of our home values with regards to the residential area. And now folks are looking to be able to actually bring their companies and bring their opportunities to the city of Stonecrest, which creates a solid revenue base for us. Those are the solid priorities of what needs to happen.
All right, and Mr. Douglas Favors, what about your opinion of the pressing issues for Stonecrest?
Two biggest pressing issues for me and living in Stonecrest is going to be economic development. It's also going to be education. Economic development, again, under my platform with code enforcement, we can attract folks to come and do business in our area if we allow ourselves to become attractive. It is not something you can just say. And it just, voila, I want you to come out here, so come out here and start your business or bring business to our area. That's not how it works. You have to lay something down that allows people and businesses to come out to your area and start those businesses. That attraction starts at home, and that's the platform I run. Education is something that comes in twofold. You have to have those people attracted. Now, I always use the same example. If you go and you are going to buy a home right now, still to this day, and since selling homes altogether, the one and two things that people look at is going to be the area, and that is by the eye. You got to know the area, and then you want to know the education. You don't care if there's a mall close. The first thing you're thinking when you're buying a home is, if I drive to this area, do I feel good about driving there when I come home, and are the schools any good? So those are the two pressing, biggest pressing points is going to be economic development and laying the foundation for that to happen, and education.
All right.
Charles Hill. I know we need transparent leadership. We need innovative leadership. We need leaders that are going to bring the type of businesses to our community that are going to inspire positive growth and development. I've said on a number of occasions that we need businesses in our community that are not only going to bring medium to upper income salaries to the community, but we also need businesses that are going to offer internships and the opportunity for our younger people, especially our teenagers that are in high school, to have experience and exposure to the jobs of the future. We cannot be left behind as a community. We need our younger people to be trained so that they can be competitive in what is rapidly becoming a global marketplace. We need transparency in local government because, again, going back to the issues of crime and the issues of education in our community, while the city of Stonecrest is not directly responsible for those two issues immediately upon the city government taking office, we still have to be able to work with our other stakeholders in the community to improve on the level of policing in the area. We have to get parents back active and involved in the school system. I'm running on a platform of transparency. I said that if I am elected to this position, I will not take a salary if I am elected. I'm in favor of term limits. So we have to have transparency based on a number of things that have happened in our community in the past. Thank you.
Let me ask this, because I was researching for you guys to come on the program, just to understand your platform, to understand any issues that you may have had with each other. Can I quickly just put this out here? Whoever wins, will the other support that person for the city of Stonecrest? Does anybody have an objection to that?
I'm in full favor of supporting what is in the best interest of our community. And I want to see whatever city government takes office after tomorrow's elections be successful.
I can't say that I'm in support of that. There are some things that are too big of a difference between me and maybe another candidate that that will not allow me to fully support if that person is in leadership. I will do my best to support the things that we have common ground on, but in some of those other areas, just we can't do that.
And Jason, what about you, sir?
I would fully support either person, because this journey has been about creating this city opportunity for all of us. And the voters will get an opportunity to say who they really want to lead in this opportunity. So if it's someone else, I'll still support it fully, wholeheartedly.
All right. I saw this in the public domain, and I have to ask, because it goes directly to the ability for you guys to work together, okay? This was on the public profile of Douglas Favors. You put a text message conversation between you and Mr. Jason Larry. You put that in the public domain. This was not something that I hacked or found out through an unsourced source. I received it from your public file. And it says, from Larry, says, Mr. Favors, you have 24 hours to take my logo off your site. You are using my intellectual properties illegally. Run for mayor if you like, but you will not steal from me. Then your response, according to this file, is what logo, again, I don't have, or whatever steal anything, whatever logo you speak of is amiss. If you're referring to the article posted on Facebook, please revisit intellectual property. Thanks. Also, the response from Mr. Jason Larry was, are you stupid? You're using the Stonecrest logo that we developed and own on this very site. So, yes, you are stealing. Come up with your own graphics and be mad enough to challenge me head on if you can. Develop your own material, as you didn't work to do anything to start this city. Your response, wow, you should really tone down the rhetoric, sir. You could have easily been more clear from Jump Street. I've done nothing to start this city, question mark. You sound pretty arrogant and ignorant because you don't know what I've done. Don't mess with me again. Thanks. First question. This question is for Douglas Favors. Did you utilize intellectual property of someone else in your Facebook post, page, or website?
Okay, due to the law of the intellectual property, being aware obviously does not excuse me, but I was not aware that a graphic that I used had a piece of the Stonecrest logo on it that I was not aware was the official logo of an ownership from Mr. Larry. Again, once I was aware that that was the logo that he spoke of, it was gone. It was not.
You removed it immediately?
It was not even that was gone. It was done in less than 24 hours. I'm not the type of person. The message was very abrasive to me, because that was literally what you don't know behind the message is that was literally the first time that me and Mr. Larry had spoken of any kind. And that's why my response was the way it was, because I literally was already thinking that running for mayor, I was hoping that it was going to be more of a cordial thing and that it was going to be all, you know, all on face value as far as the brothership of all running for a mayor and the candidates. That was something that caught me off guard.
Obviously, he came to you. It was pretty aggressive, but
yes,
it was intellectual property that you should not have used. Let me go to Jason Larry about that issue. Why were you so passionate about him not using that intellectual property?
Well, a couple of things. One is that I've gotten to know Mr. Favors very well since that point in time, and I think highly of him, as a matter of fact. His skills, his education, and the way he debates. So, but from the beginning of that, the answer to your question is that we toiled and strove for 4 years to get this done, and we walked through the halls of the Capitol and was able to get a majority GOP House and Senate to vote for us. And that was some heavy, heavy lifting. And I didn't know Mr. Favors. I hadn't seen him out in public before. Hadn't seen him at any of the meetings. So I took a quick aggression to that. But since then, Mr. Favors and I, we have no problems. We've gotten to know each other very well.
You guys chopped this up as an honest mistake. Maybe you overreacted slightly and everything's cool.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. We got more on the other side. We got more questions. Call us up, 404-892-2703. If you have a question for one of the mayoral candidates for the newly formed city of Stonecrest, 404-892-2703. You can also pose your question on the Facebook group page, Real Talk with Rashad Ritchie. Real Talk with Rashad Ritchie. News and Talk 1380, WAOK. All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Welcome back. I'm still with the city of Stonecrest mayor candidates, Douglas Favors, Charles Hill, and Jason Larry. They are all in studio with me. Ladies and gentlemen, something I talked about earlier this morning. One of the most egregious, one of the most extreme things I've seen in a very long time, this mailer that hit referencing one of the candidates, Mr. Charles Hill II. Not only do they place the late Anthony Hill in this picture, they claim that Charles Hill, the candidate, is connected somehow to Anthony Hill, which is completely untrue. They claim that he has mental illnesses, which he said is completely untrue. Dirty. Extremely dirty. And I will say this. Whoever is behind this, I will help the family of Anthony Hill sue you. As a matter of fact, I may pay the legal bill, knowing that no money will come from this, but to make an example of you. One of the worst mailers I've ever seen. There's one thing about negative mailers. Negative mailers usually are true, but they're negative. This is a dirty mailer. Dirty mailers are negative and happen to be completely untrue. I will not dignify this mailer with asking Mr. Hill, is any of this true? I simply won't dignify it. He can volunteer whatever he chooses, but I will not dignify that. Let me play the Channel 2 news coverage of this mailer.
I'm not dissuaded.
Charles Hill is pressing on with his campaign for the first ever mayor of Stonecrest in southeast DeKalb County.
Good afternoon. My name is Charles Hill. I'm running for mayor of the city of Stonecrest, Georgia.
After this mailer appeared in his neighbor's mailboxes, calling Hill mentally ill, bipolar, and manic depressive.
This flyer is malicious in its intent. It's totally inaccurate. I have no history or record of mental illness.
The mailer shows Hill's photo next to a picture of Anthony Hill, a veteran shot 2 years ago while naked and unarmed. The DeKalb County officer responsible for his death has been indicted.
The photo of Anthony Hill, right moments before he was shot and killed, this is totally unacceptable. And the folks that are responsible for it, they're going to be held accountable.
When you look at this flyer, what is your reaction?
It's really sad.
We showed the flyer to people in DeKalb County's newest city.
That's just dirty politics.
You ruin people's life like that.
It's pretty ridiculous, like, that you can sit there and just pull anything off the internet, you know, take a picture and try and compare it to a politician just because you want to smear his name. It's really sad.
We went to the return address printed on the flyer. It's a wooded lot.
I can't believe someone would do this.
Yeah, pretty extreme. I have Charles Hill. Listen, sir. I would be fuming over this madness. What are your thoughts about this?
I'm really hurt by it.
Yeah.
Can't believe somebody would do this. I've tried to maintain my composure throughout all of this, just because there's falsehoods throughout the flyer that pertain to me and my father.
Right.
But also for someone to interject someone into this flyer because they have the same last name as me and they're a light-skinned black male And from afar, based on the image that's on the flyer, it's almost as if it's trying to depict me as the person that is actually on the flyer. And that's just totally inaccurate. My heart sank out because I followed the Anthony Hill case.
Right.
I am in support of his family. I think what has been done is malicious beyond it's far beyond anything I've ever seen in the realm of politics or elected office. And I'm with you 110%. I think whoever is behind this, we're going to find them, because the print house that published this, their code is on that mailer.
Yeah.
And we're going to get to the bottom of it. And whoever is behind it, they got hell to pay, because the community is angry about it. We don't know who it is just yet, but we're going to find out. And when we do, they're going to have some serious, serious legal problems on their hands.
And I think politically this completely backfired on whoever was behind it, because universally people are on your side with this. Let me ask for the record. Let me ask directly. Douglas Favors, did you have anything to do with this, or do you know who had anything to do with this, this mailer?
That is a resounding no. Again, I've also only been in the city for going in my fourth year, so I really could say wouldn't even know where to begin if I had anything to do with this at all.
Okay. And to Jason Larry, have you been involved in this, or anyone from your camp, or anyone that you have knowledge of?
Absolutely not. It was the most despicable thing that I've ever seen. And I actually want to applaud Mr. Hill for being able to have a press conference today to cover those issues and make sure he was transparent with regards to those things, as I did last week, you know, quite frankly, with my finances. And who's ever behind that, they should go to jail, actually, because that's terrible. How can you use a deceased veteran and depict that person and then push it toward this young man? It's absolutely ridiculous. And it's just incredible.
And according to one article I've read, they estimate this mailer cost probably around $7,000 to send. So we're not talking about somebody who said, let me put $200 and mess with this guy. We're talking about somebody who put enough money to try to make a dent in this election against Charles Hill. My statement stands. Do you think somebody who supports one of you guys did this without your knowledge, thinking they were helping you?
Not from my standpoint. Absolutely not.
Mr. Favors?
All right, so I was waiting for that question there. So I'm the guy in the middle. I'm the guy who's got no name attached to any of this by anybody's idea. But here's the biggest problem with that for me. That was a good question that you asked, because contrary to any kind of interactions I've had with either Mr. Hill or Mr. Larry, I have to stand on my own two feet in saying that this ad is and this flyer does not, and I want to be real clear about this, does not necessarily mean that whoever did it is trying to get Mr. Hill not elected or Mr. Larry not elected. So let me be the one to tell you right now, I'm the one that's standing there when the smoke settles, and I'm telling you right now, I have to put my fences on both sides, and I couldn't tell you if that is supposed to go against or for Mr. Hill or against or for Mr. Larry, because it can play that for either one.
Let me, and I saw a report that said that this played so well, Mr. Hill, and I have to ask this. This played so well for you as far as the public outrage against those who would try to do this to you, that maybe you commissioned it to be done. What's your response to something like that?
An absolute hell no. I had nothing to do with this. Like I said, the person who is responsible for it, we're going to crucify him, because this is something that should never happen. So, you know, I'm going to be right there with you whenever this charge is led. We're going to get to the bottom of it. In terms of gaining any type of advantage or leverage, this is slander. Somebody is going to read this flyer and is going to think that Charles Hill is bipolar. He has some type of mental condition. They're going to think that, you know, I'm some handicapped person whose father is taking care of him. And that's just not true. Like I said, I have a degree from Morehouse, from Harvard. I'm finishing at Yale. I have no mental illness. And this is sick, because there are a number of people that are out there that are suffering with real mental illness and mental disorders. So aside from Anthony Hill just being a veteran, he was someone who really needed the care and help of society. And to a certain degree, we failed him, because, you know, the police department is a representation most often of its people and what type of policies are in place.
All right, let's go to Lisa. Lisa has a question from Facebook. This is for all three of you. How important are town hall meetings for accountability of office, and would you commit to hold them for your constituents? And I know she means consistently. And Mr. Hill, I'll start with you on that question.
I think town hall meetings are very important. I think that it allows for folks that are in the community to work with and to speak with their elected office holders. I think that these meetings should be broadcast with enough time for both those folks that are serving the people or looking to serve the people, as well as folks that are in the community, have enough time and enough of an opportunity to schedule and to make time to attend them, because they're very important for transparency and for folks that are in the community to hold their office holders accountable.
Okay.
Again, Douglas Favors, I have already mentioned and said out there at Forums and Debates and the last couple times I was on radio also that I am very big on town hall meetings. I definitely, if I'm your mayor, you will see me at minimum once a month. There will be a set date and time that will occur every month at the least that we discuss what you all want for your city.
Ms. Larry.
Town hall meetings are the cornerstone of what happens with regards to citizens' advocacy and what they desire. This is how we won cityhood. We had every week, we had a meeting, a town hall meeting for the past 4 years to make sure we were understanding the desires, the wants, and the particulars of the citizens in this area. And that's how it grew, Mr. Ritchie, from live, work, play to worship, shop, educate, those six keys that we talked about. So specifically, not only are they paramount, they should be recorded, and they should be at least twice a month.
This is from Ebony. Ebony lives in Stonecrest. Ebony says, and I assume this is for you, Mr. Larry, ask him how can the Jason 5 pass legislation with the community in mind if they are all friends? Doesn't that mean they'll all support each other's politics? Does he feel this is a huge conflict of interest? That is for you, sir. Go ahead.
So first of all, I read that in front of Crossroads also about the Jason 5, and thank you for that, whoever that is. But there is no Jason 5. There is no conglomerate of people that are getting together, if you will, to be able to make sure things happen in that particular arena. So whoever wins, wins. And the thing about that is that you have 20 people running for office. And if you've been to these forums, these council representatives, the ones that are running for council, they are very mature, very smart, very good leaders in their own right, as the mayor or candidates are. Short of it is this, whoever wins, wins. And I'm the type of leader that's a collaborative. And I'm ready to work with whoever wins in that particular position.
All right, let me ask this. This is from Sirius on Facebook.
All right.
Referencing, obviously, the mailer that went out. Ask them if they will take a lie detector test. And, Mr. Favors, I'll start with you and go on.
Definitely. There's nothing else I can add to that. I'll take one today.
Okay.
Right now. No question.
All right.
I don't have a problem with that.
All right, cool. All right, we got more on the other side, guys. We're with the three mayoral candidates for the newly formed city of Stonecrest. You don't want to miss it coming up to the final segment. News and Talk 1380 WAOK. All right, welcome back. 404-892-2703. Listen, I got all three mayoral candidates in the studio with me from the newly formed city of Stonecrest. We have Mr. Douglas Favors, we have Charles Hill, and we have Jason Larry. I have callers, and I need to get to these callers. Let's go to Deborah, line one. Deborah, good day. Welcome.
Thank you. I just had two questions. My first question is, I hope I didn't miss it. How do the three candidates feel about the sports arena? And more importantly, do either one of you have any suggestions or plans as to what you can do for the young black youth in the Stonecrest area, and more so the ones that are at higher risk would be the young black men, especially since all of you are distinguished black men in the area and the community. What do you have in regards to that part or that generation that are coming up?
Thank you, Deborah. Listen for the answer offline. So the question is, what do you think about the sports arena? We talked about that on my show a few weeks ago. And also, young black youth, how do you help them? Mr. Favors, I will begin with you this time.
All right, so sports arena, I am in favor of the sports arena itself, the idea of a business coming and doing that kind of thing for the community. What I'm not in favor of is how it's done and making sure that we take a really good look at making sure that it's done in a way that is actually going to help the community. And when I say that, I'm a big proponent of having some kind of metric that says you either got to hire a certain amount of people or you got to pay a certain amount. You have to do things that are saying you are literally doing something for the community, and that has to be looked at very hard. But I'm a former sports athlete myself, so I would never be against promoting sports and having something for that. Now, I want to jump right into the youth, and especially the young black men. I was actually a on-site coordinator for Goodwill Industries of the Northern Rivers over in Columbus, and I did an at-risk youth program, and it was an on-site program where I managed people in a young men and women that were at risk from their high schools and had been to jail and things like that in a Ben and Jerry's location. And what I did was manage them. We had classroom and we had work. And where what we would do is I'd come up with a curriculum and then reinforce it in the workplace. So, yes, I definitely got very big ideas for the young folks.
All right, let's go. And we don't have much time. Let's go to Mr. Hill, Sports Arena, and Young Black Youth.
Okay, I'll try to be very, very brief. Based on my research into the proposed sports facility, it's going to be a private venture. It will not be able to be, to the best of my knowledge, it's not going to be a public venture. And private ventures are for profit. Based on my research, based on the information that is provided online, research I've done, the estimated economic impact of DeKalb County soccer facility and the Atlanta sports complex. This study was done by Discover DeKalb, the Carl Vinson Institute, University of Georgia, and ASC sports complex. The research does not support that this will be a great facility for the area. I do not believe that it's going to bring 2,000 jobs. I think we need to move more into the realm of trying to get tech innovation. In terms of young black men, I'm a product of Lithonia High School. I served as a youth pastor at predominantly black churches. So I know the issues that are plaguing our community, and I want to work in the community to alleviate a number of these issues.
All right, Mr. Larry.
I'm completely in support of the sports complex for several reasons. One, as a former concert promoter, I know what an arena can do with regards to being able to bring revenue to a facility. 14 soccer fields, 3 baseball fields, a 15,000-seat arena, a 5,000-covered area, and 2,000 jobs. With guarantee, 25% of those jobs will go to the people that are in Stonecrest and up to 50% depending upon their skill level. So, yes, I'm in 100% of it because before then, Mr. Ritchie, that place was tall grass and weeds and nothing else was going to come to it, and it doesn't cost the city a dime. It's tax revenue for us. Number two, about our black youths. That's when we talked about live, work, play, worship, shop, educate. On the education side of this, those corporations that are looking to move to Stonecrest are interested, and some of them already committed to being able to put money back in our schools so we can designate that toward young black youth for jobs. That is the road to our salvation, careers and jobs.
All right, we have Shalise. She has a question. Shalise, go ahead.
Hey, Rashad, thank you so much for taking my call. You asked the question earlier. I basically have a comment. It's not a question. But the gentleman that he didn't get his name. You asked that if the other person wins, would they support the other candidate? And he was a no. So you and I were tweeting last night, that's me, about the whole South Fulton issue that I posted. If I were voting in that election, I wouldn't vote for him. Because, you know, we have to put aside pettiness, and we have to work together, whether you agree with the other candidate or not.
Thank you,
so
sister.
That's my comment.
I appreciate your call, and he didn't exactly say no. I will give you an opportunity to go ahead and rebuttal that.
Okay, so I didn't say.
And this is Mr. Favors.
This is Mr. Favors,
by the way.
Douglas Favors. It's not a no. I said that on the issues that whoever is elected that we disagree, I will work to better that congruency between. But as far as being different on issues, I would definitely leave the word pettiness out because it's very important that you speak your mind and that you investigate things that may not be the same for you.
All right, and we have KO line 4. KO, good day. Welcome.
Hey, thanks, Rashad. And thank you, candidates. Quick question. So two of your city council candidates have said that they will not agree to any tax increases. I think there's a two-year hold, but beyond that, they've said that they wouldn't do any tax increases. Are you as definite in your response as relates to the potential to grow the city? Because sometimes it takes money to make money. So what are your thoughts on potential taxes in the future?
All right. Thank you, sir. Mr. Hill, I'll begin with you.
I'll say that I am not in favor of taxes going up, but I understand that there are sometimes things that have to be taken into consideration. But at this juncture, I'm not in favor of taxes rising, and I'm very concerned about House Bill 600.
All right, Mr. Favors.
Again, not in favor of taxes going up, but I'm a plain guy, man. Nobody's in favor of taxes going up, but I am in favor of paying more for more things that you get.
All right, and Mr. Larry.
Certainly not in favor of taxes going up, because even with the study that we've commissioned, $10 million for the gross revenue of the city, $8 million return, which is a $2 million surplus that we have.
All right. Listen, I only have 30 seconds each for you guys to do a closing. I will begin with Mr. Favors on that closing. Go ahead.
Favors, for the number 4, mayor.com is where you can find out more information and ask questions that you need answered by me. I'm running off of beautification by code enforcement. The bottom line is we have to have the foundation to do any of these other things that everybody's talking about, from economic development to better schools. The area itself has to be improved, and we can start those things day one with me as your mayor. Please vote for me tomorrow. Favors for mayor. I am the first box on the entire ballot. Thank you.
All right. Mr. Larry?
Jason Larry. Jason Larry from mayor.com. Live, work, play, worship, shop, educate. We have a full complement of the things that we can do in our community. It is structured with regards to being able to have economic development in that region, handling our industrial park jobs, our executive jobs for the commercial area, and being able to increase our residential home values, eliminating as best as we can for crime and those type of things, and, of course, adding to our educational structure. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Charles Hill.
My name is Charles Hill. Please visit my website, charleshillforstonecrest.com. I just want to encourage everyone in the city of Stonecrest, do your research. Learn about the candidates that are seeking to represent you in public office. I'm not going to tell you to vote for me. I'm going to tell you to get informed. We have real serious issues in our community, and you have to get out and vote. The number of voters that show up tomorrow at the polls, both in the city of Stonecrest and South Fulton, are going to be a representation of the folks that are in the community and how we're perceived of doing our civic duty. So please, please, please just get out and vote, no matter who you're supporting. God bless you. And thank you, Dr. Ritchie, for having us on.
Thank you all. I appreciate the opportunity to have this forum, and I'm sure the listeners and voters do as well. This has been Real Talk with Rashad Richard. I am the realest man in talk radio. Thanks to my producer, DJ Sturgis. I appreciate you, homie, for holding me down. All of my great guests today, and to you, especially to you, the WAOK listener. Without you, there is no us. If I've agreed with you or disagreed with you, just know I've done it all out of love. And to Gene Ross, the boss, who makes all of this happen every single day. Follow me on Twitter at Rashad1380, at R-A-S-H-A-D-1380. Follow me, I will follow you. Join the Facebook group page, Real Talk with Rashad Richard. Real Talk with Rashad Richard. Honest exchange of ideas is the purpose. Find me on Instagram, Rashad.Rich or Rashad_Rich. Either way is fine. If you would like me to speak to your nonprofit, group, organization, church, or school, send all requests to richie316@gmail.com. All of my archived interviews and articles can be found at either v-103.com or waok.com. More importantly than all of that is this. Remember to get connected or stay connected to a mentoring group or nonprofit in your local community. None of us are perfect, but anytime you help someone become a better them, it always helps you become a better you. I'm living proof. Tough times don't last always, but tough people always do. Until next time, Atlanta, be well.